Here we go. Look, many years ago when I first set out to write a novel, my very first move, naturally enough, was to check out the arts funding bodies and to see whether I could maybe get a grant. And I was very soon, very rapidly disavowed of this notion. The Australia Council, I was told, does not fund crime or romance fiction. No rooting, no shooting is official Australian government literary policy. Likewise, nor did it fund fantasy, horror, or science fiction. These were apparently all categories of what is known as genre writing. Now, if you don't know, genre, from the French genre, means, in literary terms, shit. As deployed by the literary critics. Now, science fiction, one of the dreaded genres, is where Rob cut his teeth or made his bones or whatever you do, or in the Iridian mines of Argagulos 5. And he's clearly got no fear of literary articles. He has embraced the shit. Not only has he embraced it, he's actually slid sideways into the crime category with the Millennium job. A fresh and red hot go at the dreaded whodunit bracket. So, having embarked on this literally dodgy course, what sort of mystery has Rob produced? Well, I can tell you that it is not hard-boiled, nor is it a cozy, although some of the classes are actually quite snug, but it's not a cozy. There is no serial killer or wise-cracking private eye. It's not a courtroom drama or a forensic drill down. It's a police procedural, where the police procedure is taken for walkies on what I think is somewhat loose lead. And that lead is Detective Inspector Danny Winner Wynn, our police protagonist. Now, it used to be that your fictive homicide detective was middle-aged, melancholic, alcoholic, in a crumpled suit, the poor diet, ketchup stains on his tie, string of ex-wives, and fractious relationships with his superiors and his colleagues. And that figure, of course, has faded into history. It was in turn supplanted by a female forensic profiler who wore Armani suits, had stock options, and W. And from that point on, the, as it were, repertoire of detectives has really, really widened out. Danny Wynn is the latest addition to that. And he's certainly neither a middle-aged, melancholic alcoholic nor a high-powered woman in a Chanel suit. If anything, he is remarkably, one might even say suspiciously, a clean living Clive. So I say suspiciously because he is, of course, also a high ranking member of the Victoria Police, so. I mean, it's an organisation who decides on its leadership by knife fighting, rather dingy, so I don't know what Danny's chances of promotion above the level of Chief Inspector are, Detective Inspector. But The enigma of Danny Wynn I'll leave to the reader, and I'll move on to that other aspect, which is the essential ingredient in much contemporary crime fiction, and certainly historically since the days of Sherlock Holmes, and that is the location. Now, setting is sometimes considered a character in itself in crime fiction. And Roberts found a very interesting and unique way of evoking Melbourne. Our city, as described by him, is not a city of street names, of history, architecture, or even of weather. His city is defined by the precision with which various characters order their various coffees. No dialogue happens without first determining whose was the flat white and whose was the double espresso. Who had the sugar and who doesn't. In fact, the police in this seem to spend more time in coffee shops than cop shops. In fact, when Danny Wynn, our hero, arrives in Los Angeles, and that's a bit of a spoiler, there is an international component. Free trip to the States, as they might have put it down at the cop shop, if they were ever there. When he arrives in Los Angeles, the first thing he does when he emerges from immigration at the airport is go to the airport Starbucks and order a coffee so he can compare standards. I think this mark stamps him as a Melbourne character, definitively. But there's one passage, I think, where Rob, you do get Melbourne a bit wrong. Terribly wrong. Deirdre is one of the characters in this, one of the key players, has the hots for Lanky Steve, a former star player for St Kilda and currently the club's PR frontman. This, of course, is the essential burst. Unresolved sexual tension. So there's an element of sexual tension here, but another spoiler, it's not hers for very long before it's burst. And it's burst in chapter 33. So if you like to read the dirty bits first, just go there. So, at their first meeting, their first date, Deirdre declares to Steve, "I'm not into football." I'm just trying to crack on with this guy. And then get this, by simply declining to spend the afternoon hanging out with him, she passes up an opportunity to watch the Saints play from the club VIP super box. I'm sorry, Rob. I mean, this is just incredible. I mean, this is just unbelievable. I mean, who is going to pass up a chance to see the Saints play under those conditions, even someone that's not in the football? So, back to the drawing board on the footy front. As for the plot, let's just say for a newcomer to crime that Rob knows how to get the ball rolling. The body appears, not in the first chapter, not on the first page, but in the first paragraph. A woman wakes up with a stiff beside her in bed. He is a complete stranger. He is also dead. And she does what anyone would do, of course. She calls a friend. Now, they say a friend is somebody who'll help you move house. Takes a very, very good friend help you move a body. Deirdre has just such a friend. And so the case begins. The game's afoot, as Sherlock liked to say. I'd like to congratulate Rob, notwithstanding his little slip on the attraction of Harry Watson's killer, on the publication of the Millennium Job. It's a great debut. I'd like to welcome you, The Life of Crime. Your novel, sum it up, is a double shot macchiato with a, from an intriguing grind with a definitely mysterious aroma. Welcome to the racket.